Super Sunday of idolatry and whoredom by the heathen, or Super Surge of the Holy Spirit to regenerate your heart, to turn you away from these things, to come out from among them and worship the true and living
God. If you got your pass, you can come in right now.
You better have God pass over your sins, or you will be judged by him according to your ways, and you're going to be repaid by him for all your abominations. Today is one of them, as we go a-whoring from God in bars to watch men in a filthy halftime show with abominable filth and all kinds of perversion. What a waste of life. What a waste of time. There's a God who made you, you're accountable to, and you're going to be damned under his wrath in hell unless you bow to his son and come out of this idolatry. That's natural, and only God can enable you to do that. And we plead with you in the love of God to do that. God commands you to repent and to believe the gospel. Flee from the wrath to come. Come out of all this abominable horror. Well, might be, who knows if it's your last one. You see the impenitence? The day is coming. The day is coming and burning like an oven. When all the proud, he says, all who do wickedly will be stubble. You think about that. The nations will not be able to endure his indignation. The eyes of the Lord are upon the righteous. His ears are open to their prayer, but the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. There's none righteous, no, not one. There's none who understand. There's none that seeketh after God. There is no fear of God before their eyes. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. The knowledge of the holy is understanding. It's by the fear of the Lord men depart from evil. Come to Christ. Repent and believe in the gospel. Today, if you hear his voice, harden not your heart. Everyone is going to die from this disease of the soul. What is that disease? It's called sin. What is sin? Breaking God. Why are you here in Sin City? To whore yourself out with a bunch of abominable things this whole weekend. What do we come here to do? This is a reality. We're going to use the biblical language, too. It's called spiritual adultery. We give our bodies, minds, souls, everything that we are to false gods, to serve ourselves, the lust of our heart. That's our natural disposition. It's our inclination to do that. We're bent on evil. We're hell-bent on autonomy, governing our own lives. You can't even control your next breath or heartbeat. You can't even prevent yourself from getting a 24-hour flu. I mean, it's by God's grace you breathe and have a pulse. It's by God's grace you have sunshine on your skin. It's by God's grace you're able to walk and tie your shoe and walk around with legs that work and arms that work and fingers that work and eyes that see, physical senses. It's by God's grace alone, even though that we hate God. We hate the true God. We love evil. God is still kind to the unthankful and evil. God is good to all. His tender mercy over all his works. But we have to realize that in our condition of enmity with God, you're in great danger. You're in that sinful nature. You're at enmity with the holy God, not a place you want. That's why we're here today. Not because we're religious people. Not because we're trying to be mean. Not because the mere reason is the love of God. The love of God which passes knowledge. That the Lord Jesus Christ came to seek and to save that which is lost by coming, becoming flesh, to live the perfect life you and I could not live. To save us from sin and eternal damnation in hell, the Lord Jesus is the only one to live perfectly, to lay down his life, to fulfill all the requirements of divine law that you and I have broken, and then conquer Satan, sin, and the grave by rising again. It's those who trust in the Lord Jesus Christ that will not be condemned but have everlasting life. It's those who humble themselves, realizing that you are that man or woman, that you are that miserable, wretched, poor, blind, naked, sinful man that deserves to burn in a low hell, but Jesus came to save sinners. Jesus died on the cross to save you from your sins if you believe upon him. Have you believed? That's the question today. If not, then you're under the wrath of God as you breathe. Every moment you eat, you drink, and you sleep under the wrath of God. And your foot's going to slip in due time. God is going to require you. So I've seen more people die this year. And my own family and people that I know personally have died the month of January than I have in my entire 40 years of being alive. This year, I mean, it's so sudden. Some of you might not make it out of here this weekend. You might die in your sin. I don't know. God knows. And God's warning you again today through his people. You want to mock it? Go ahead. You want to laugh at it? Say, I don't care. You know why? Because I know that this is the truth. I know that Jesus Christ, you're going to stand before him, not me, and you will give an account. And if you don't have Christ, you're going to wish you were never born when you're burning in eternal hell. I don't want that for you. God hates your life of anarchy against him, and he will destroy you in due time unless you repent and bow to Christ.
That goes for, I don't care how much money you have, you're going to lose it all. The moment you die, everything you own's gone. The moment you're, all your belongings, your land, your house, your car, everything you live for is ripped away. When you die, you're going to die, folks. You're going to die. You're not alive, but I'm going to die in Christ. I have eternal life. That's the joy. I have Christ. That's the grace of God. I deserve to burn in the low hell, but I have Christ. So when I die, there's no fear of death because Jesus saved me. He had that. You're trying to save your lives. You can have no power over death. You're trying to save your own skin. Hoping you're going to take all the things you do. There's wisdom in taking vitamins and doing things to keep the body healthy. Yes, but you're living for this temporary 50, 80 years and you're going to burn in hell for an eternity. What a waste of a life. What a waste of time. This world offers you nothing but lies without Christ. Your whole life is a lie. It is vanity. It's vexation of spirit. If you don't have the Lord Jesus Christ, folks, everything you have is absolutely worthless in the end. It is. Go read the book of Ecclesiastes again. And if Jesus Christ had not saved my soul, I would run straight to hell. I would love all. I loved all the evil things that you love here today. Why are you out here? I'd be doing the same thing you are. But because of the joy of the Lord, and God, I know that Jesus Christ the Lord is the King of glory, and every knee is going to bow to the Lord Jesus Christ, every tongue is going to confess he's God. You need to get right with him now for your own sake to glorify God, because he's worthy of all praise, honor, glory, strength, and power. You must be born again.
The Bible says to everything in this life there's a season, a time to live, a time to die. A time to build, a time to destroy.
Right.
There's the summer season, fall season, winter season, spring season. None of those seasons last forever. Everything comes to an end eventually. And right now you're in the season where you're living. But there will also be a season when you die. So friends, don't push aside this message. Don't take this message lightly. What if you die within the next hour?
It's true.
Your friends, your family, boyfriend, girlfriend, mother, father, they won't be there for you on judgment day to plead your cause. They won't say to God, oh, he was a good man, she was a good woman. No, you're going to stand naked before God. Naked meaning that you will be exposed for what you truly are. All those sins that you hide in the cracks and crevices and dark places of your heart and mind.
That's right.
Will be exposed.
That the moss is hiding in there.
And all of creation and God will see you for what you really are. A wicked, hell-bound sinner. Oh, friends, we plead with you today on behalf of Christ. Be reconciled to God. Have peace with your Maker. God is creator. You're a creation. He made you in your mother's womb. He gives life and he takes away life. One day you're going to die, and you're going to give an account. And unless you repent of your sin and trust in Jesus Christ alone, you will perish. Jesus said, unless you repent, you will perish. Our repentance is a change of mind. Stop going your way and go God's way. Stop thinking you know it all. Stop thinking that you have it all together when you really don't.
Revival God, before
it's
too late. Amend your ways and your doings, declares the Lord. Put away the evil from before my eyes.
Glory to God.
And be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, and times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord.
He who has the Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, has life. For he who does not have the Son shall not see life.
Right.
Humble yourselves, for God gives grace to the humble, but he resists and rejects the proud. Pride comes before the fall, and a haughty spirit before destruction. Don't be destroyed in your sins. Be redeemed. by the blood of the Lamb. Seek the Lord while he still may be found. While you still have breath in your lungs, cry out to God to have mercy upon your soul.
Happy, healthy, comfortable, wealthy, physically speaking, and at the very same time be an enemy of God and we to burn in hellfire. You just watch a show about fire. Our God is a consuming fire. He would devour his adversaries. Vengeance is mine, declares the Lord. I will repay, and again, the Lord will judge his people. It's a fearful thing to fall in the hands of a living God. You need to be restored to God through faith alone in Christ, the only substitute qualified to die for the sins of his people, the eternal Son of God, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, the Lord Jesus Christ, who lived perfectly for his people, died for them on the cross to bear their guilt. His blood was shed for their souls to conquer Satan, hell, and the grave by rising again. It is those who trust in the Lord Jesus Christ alone that will be reconciled to God. It is in him that we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, according to the riches of his grace. Apart from saving grace in the Lord Jesus Christ, there's nothing but the ruthless judgment of God that awaits the ungod, that awaits the impenitent sinner, who has warned you to flee from the wrath to come, to be reconciled to God, to turn from your idols to God. Their sorrows shall be multiplied, who hasten after another god. All the gods of the nations are idols. The Lord made the heavens. Hear and give ear. Do not be proud. Give glory unto the Lord your God. Fear God and give glory to him. Repent. Turn yourselves from all of your transgressions so that sin will not be your ruin and hell will not be your lot. Trust in Christ alone to save your soul, to restore you to God. The Lord Jesus himself said, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh. That which is born of the spirit is spirit. When you're born of God, you become a child of God. You are by nature a child of wrath, accursed of God. Except you repent, you will all likewise perish.
Even more so, he came to live the life you should have lived in your place. A perfect substitute. A perfect substitute. You remember what a substitute is? Remember?
Yeah.
Don't get hit by the phone. You remember when you were in school and the teacher wasn't there that day and there was a substitute in place of the teacher? That's what Jesus did. He lived a life as a substitute because he lived a sinless life.
That's right.
Unlike you and I. Because we always sin and we need him to be our savior. There is no other name given to men whereby we must be saved. There is no other name under heaven given to men whereby we must be saved. Only the name of Christ alone is sufficient.
Praise God.
To not only wash away your sins, but to grant you the perfect righteousness that only he can give. There's your wake-up call. I wonder whose heart just stopped beating. When is your heart going to stop beating?
That's right.
You know it's going to happen. 100% of every single person within the sound of my voice, heart will one day stop. And you don't know when that is, but God does. And you better think about that, because nobody plans to die except for the real old people. But you're not old. Now is the time to do something with your life for the glory of God.
Praise.
Surrender to Jesus Christ. There is no other hope. You have no hope without Jesus Christ. You are hopeless. Walking around looking at lights.
That's
looking
right.
At naked girls. Getting drunk. Big deal. Super Bowl. Who won the Super Bowl 6 years ago? You don't remember? You know why? Because it doesn't matter. It's meaningless. We're chasing after shiny objects. When our soul was at stake.
Yeah. Because indeed you will know the truth, and the truth shall make you free.
Thank you.
So where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's liberty. So that's how we know God. If you're born of God, you're going to abide in the Word of God. You become a disciple. You become a student of Christ. It's natural. It's not something you have to do religiously. It's a natural result of the new birth. Just like you have physical instincts as human beings. When you're born, you learn how to eat, you learn how to crawl, then you learn how to walk, then you learn how to talk, and then you learn how to do other things. There's a physical standard of human development, and there's also a spiritual standard of spiritual development. It works differently, but this, you're not going to remain an infant spiritually for 30 years. That's a problem there.
Maybe you never came to a full womb. Maybe you were a miscarriage. You heard the word, but you never got born of the word.
Do you really think that God wanted you to wake up today and do this?
I don't think so. I know so. That's the difference, man. So the reality is, when you're born of the Spirit of God, there's going to be evidence of that, because you're going to grow spiritually. The Lord Jesus came to save sinners. And so when you're born of His life, He's perfect. Ma'am, we die from sin. Ma'am, we are guilty before God. What are you going to do with all your sins? Ma'am, what are you going to do? You know, you have a pandemic worse than AIDS, right? It's called sin. The body's going to rot to dust because of sin. The second death's going to be burning in a fiery hell because of sin. What are you going to do with your sins? No, the Lord God commands us to preach the gospel. That's what we're here to do, to preach the gospel. Because not because we hate, because this is the love of God. People that hate people lie to people, right? You hear all the lies every day in the news, everything else. Well, read the Bible. That's the word of God. We're going to actually hear some truth. And we don't read that because we love to lie. Jesus says, because I tell you the truth, you don't believe me. You want somebody that comes in their own name. That's the Antichrist that's coming. If you didn't know that, you're the prelude to a new world order, a global government. You have the Antichrist kingdom on the way, and you're walking oblivious to life. Most of you come out here a whoring from God with all kinds of abominable filth, and you're heaping a greater damnation upon yourself. Now repent and live. Turn from your idols to God. Turn from your wicked ways. Surrender to Christ, the true King, before He comes to take vengeance on His adversaries. Recompense His enemies. That's the great news, that no matter how vile of a wretch you are, there's no sin that exceeds the grace of God. He's able to save the uttermost of those who come to God through Him. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. Repent and believe the gospel. The kingdom of God is at hand. His kingdom is an everlasting kingdom. His dominions you have no end. The government's going to rest upon His shoulders. All these temporal kingdoms that you see now, all the kings of the earth are going to mourn because of Him. This world is passing away, and the lust of it. They're all going to go down in the end, but one king's going to reign for 1,000 years on this earth. One king reigns eternally in the heavens. That's the Lord Jesus Christ. Are you in His kingdom? Have you come into a saving relationship with Him to enter the kingdom of God by being born of His very life? You must be born again. That means born of the Holy Spirit, born of Christ. Him dwelling in you, you and Him, to love Him, to know Him, to serve Him, to be with Him forever, starting now on this earth. That's knowing God.
If Jesus was a Hebrew Israelite, what would His name be?
Well, Jesus is God.
No.
Jesus is Lord.
What would His name be?
He's been given the name above every name. At the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow, of those in heaven, of those on earth.
If a J is only 500 years old, how is it that that's salvation?
You're teaching doctrines and commandments of men.
That's Hebrew, brother.
Don't worry about that. You must be born again.
You're teaching Christianity.
What? Hebrew. You must. Don't worry about that. You're not saved according to the works of the law.
He was a Hebrew.
The just shall live by faith.
He was a Hebrew.
Doesn't matter what all the not is. You must be born of
Names
His life.
Don't change,
you can know all the head knowledge, but to know Him
Names
is eternal life.
Names don't change.
Make sure you get born again.
Names don't change.
He gives you His life. So you don't give your life, and He gives you His life, and so now you're a child of God. So if you have the life of Christ, He dwells in you. You can't keep sinning, because Jesus says, I'm the light of the world.
You can't keep sinning.
No way. You can't. See, he says, he who is born of God does not sin, for his seed remains in him, and he cannot sin because he's been born of God. It means you cannot practice habitual sin. You cannot live. You're not going to be able to. God's going to change.
So you're sinning here and there, but you're
right. And if you're able to keep sinning, the Bible says you're a bastard. He says this. He says, the Lord, whom the Lord loves, He chastens. He scourges every son whom He receives. So in other words, if God loves you and He saved you and you're His child, He's not going to let you keep doing things. He's going to harm you. He's going to intervene, and He's going to stop you from doing it. So He's going to stop you from doing it.
So if He don't stop you,
that means you're not His. That's right.
Oh, shit.
See what I'm saying? Scary stuff.
Yeah, it is. So if you don't intervene, then you're not His.
The worst thing is you're leaving you alone. If you're His, you're going to make it in, because He won't leave you. He'll never leave you nor forsake you. He said, I have loved you with an everlasting love, therefore my loving kindness I've drawn thee.
Let's just say one had a real sin, and he kept doing that sin.
Yeah.
And then he gave his life to Christ, and then he kept on sinning. I mean, is that
he never gave his life to Christ.
So he never
See what I'm saying? It's not that he lost his salvation. It's not that he came and he was, no, he says it went out from us because they were never one of us. If he came, then God, the evidence he came is that he's going to be sanctified. So he listen, there's going to be times that you're stumbling, but listen, you're not going to be comfortable. You're going to be broken. God's going to break
you. Are you going to be comfortable in your sin?
No way. You can't be, not if you're truly born again. So
truly born again.
So there's so many people that say they're born again. I'm not looking at men. This is scripture. This is what the Bible teaches. So if they're born again, that which is born of God. Read 1 John 3. Read the book of 1 John. It's 5 chapters. 1 John is by revelation. Not regular John. Is, you know, Gospel John is after Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. 1 John, 2 John, 3 John is right by revelation, the back of the Bible. 1 John. You read it's 5 chapters. It'll change. Read those 5 chapters. I'll tell you. That's for those, like he says, if he who says, I know God, and doesn't do what he says is a liar. It's not in it. It's heavy. It will rock your world, man. See, you're going to read, if you're in the Word, you're going to know that. Whosoever transgresses does not abide the doctrines of Christ, does not have God. So
if I'm a born again, I got to study his word. I just can't.
Right. Jesus said, if you abide in my word, you are my disciples indeed. You shall know
the
truth.
I need to keep studying.
You will. Oh, yeah, you will. If there's that time where you're not hungry, that's a dangerous place to be.
So I just can't be born again and don't study the word.
No, it won't be possible. Because when you're born again, it's like you can't. It's like you living and not eating. You know, you don't eat for a week or two. You know what I'm saying? It's like, if you're in the Word, you're in the Word all the time.
I need to continue in the Word.
Right.
Does that make me strong?
Oh, yeah. It's all the Word. The Word is all sufficient. Don't worry about it. See, what's happening is the devil is cunning. The devil wants you to get all these men's word, these false prophets telling you, I got a vision for you. All that. You read Jeremiah 23, man, talks about they speak a vision from their own heart, not from the mouth of the Lord. They're liars, frauds. It's not the Word. You got to be in the Word, the Bible. That's all the Word you need. That's God. That's infallible. Don't trust anybody. You got to filter it through the Word. And if you don't know the Word, you're in the most dangerous time to be alive right now, besides the days of Noah. This is going to get more deception, greater increase of delusion. God is sending strong delusions if people believe lies. He said, I will choose their delusions to bring their fears upon them. Because when I called, they didn't answer. When I spake, they did not hear. They did evil before my eyes, and they chose that which I did not delight. He's doing that.
How do you know that word is so good like that? You study.
He says, study to show yourself approved unto God, a worker that does not need to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. It's by the grace of God. If you're in the word, there's no way you can function.
I mean, you know the word because you're spitting out scripture.
I only want to give you, I'm not telling you my opinion, I'm telling you what the word says. That's all.
You're spitting that scripture. So that means you've been studying.
That's right. We got to read the.
So that means you're strong. So that means you got a relationship.
But when you're resting, you're not like striving. I'm not trying to study to be religious, I'm trying to study so I can know all this stuff. You're just resting in the word. He is the word. When he lives in you, he is the word. He's going to give you recall of the word. You just read it and spend time with him and get to prayer. You'll just digest the word. Just be there.
Okay, so
you're not like straight. I gotta read. You know, get weird. It's like you're not doing a religion. You're just reading the word.
Okay.
And then you remember that the word's gonna be in you.
Okay. Let me ask you this last question. If I'm in a certain type of sin.
Yeah.
And if I read the word, would that help me in my sin?
Oh yeah. Because either you're gonna put the word down. Or you're going to sear your conscience. You're not going to be able to keep it. If you're in the Word, of course it is. Because faith comes by hearing, and by hearing the Word of God. Faith, just you increase the faith. This is powerful. You got to read a couple of these.
I gave me one.
Did you get the blue, yellow one? Or get the other one? Which one did you get?
Okay.
Yeah, read a couple of these. This is a good doctrine here. That's good reading. I'll give you that. Okay, I'll give you. Read these two. These are good. Heavy stuff. What's your first name? Ron, good to meet you.
So if I read the word of God, I'm on a trip. If I read the word of God, I can stop my sin?
No, you can't stop your sin by anything you do. Jesus is going to stop your sin. You got to come to him. To Christ.
I won't feel comfortable.
No, you got to come to Christ. You still love that sin more than Christ, you haven't come to Christ yet. So if you love that sin and you're trying to hold on to that, you haven't come to Christ, and God knows what it is. So you cry out to the Lord to deliver you from it. If you want it gone, it'll be gone immediately. You cry out to Jesus, he'll take it away.
Take it away?
Oh, yeah. If you're genuine, he knows
you're...
He says, anyone who calls the name upon the name of the Lord, he shall be saved. He who comes, he'll know why he's cast out. He's able to save the uttermost, those who come to God through him. He came to take away our sins. In him there is no sin. So if you come to Christ and ask, that's the miracle, he will rip that out of your life so fast and make you, he will destroy it. He came to destroy the works of the devil. He conquered sin. And no sin exceeds the grace of God. So you cry out to God to save you. No sin exceeds the grace of God. He says, you shall call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. He will save his people from, so of course he's going to save you from your sin.
What do I need to do?
Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you shall be saved.
That's it?
God commands you to repent and believe the gospel.
Just believe. Are you telling me all I need to do is just believe?
Well, believing, right? What does it mean? What does it mean to believe? The heart is deceitful. Listen, the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked.
Okay, so what do I
so how do you know you believe?
Yeah,
how do you? He says the evidence is going to be you'll know them by their fruits. He says, bring forth fruit, meet with repentance. Even now the axe is laid to the root of the trees. Every tree that does not bring forth good fruit is hewn down and thrown into the fire.
So what if I believe and I still keep sinning?
Then you haven't believed. You haven't come to a saving belief. You haven't come to saving belief.
Well, how do I do that?
Only God can do it. You can't do it. Seek the Lord and live.
What do I need to do?
Get in the Word. Cry out to God to save
me.
Well, start reading. Say, Lord, I mean, whatever it is, say, Lord, save me. Lord, have mercy. Just cry out to God till he saves you. You need to get the Word and just read. Do whatever you got to do to cry out to God till you know you're saved. Well, the Spirit of God bears witness with your spirit that you're a child of God. Oh yeah, go get the book of Romans. Go get the book of 1 John. Go get the book of Galatians and read it. And God, I can't deliver myself. You can't save yourself from your sin. You can't stop doing that sin. There's no way to do it. Only God can deliver you. Call upon the name of the Lord. He conquered Satan, hell, and the grave. Praise the Lord. We pray for you right now. Father God, I thank you for Montreal. Lord, I thank you for letting me be here tonight. Lord, I thank you for letting me share with them, Lord God, your word. For unprofitable service, doing our duty to do. We have no power in and of ourselves to do anything. Lord, you know every thought in his heart and every cell in his body and every secret, Lord God. You said you set our secret sins in the light of your countenance, Lord God. There's no escape. There's no creature hidden from your sight. All things are naked and open to the eyes of him who must give an account. So, Lord, I ask that you save him from all of his sins, Lord God. You deliver him. I pray you grant him repentance, Lord God. Turn him to the love of sin. I pray that he be broken and contrite before you. I pray you'd open his eyes, turn him from darkness, light, the power of Satan unto God. Lord, do that work in him, Lord God. I pray that he be transformed, or he would not waste any more of his time or his life in vanity, Lord God. I pray that he run to Christ. Lord, do that work in him, Lord God, so he'd know you and fall in love with you more than everything else and all else, that he'd truly understand the word. We ask you to grant him repentance unto life, Lord God. Whatever it takes for him to be truly born of the Spirit of God, we pray it be done in his life, Lord God. We pray you destroy every work of the devil. And I pray you bind the evil one and snatch the seed out of his heart. In Jesus' name, amen.
I believe I received that. I received that prayer.
Praise the Lord.
I believe I received that prayer.
Where do you live now?
I live here.
Yeah.
I received that prayer. And you know what? I'm going to go make a change.
Brother, you come out. There's a good. We go to the. I don't live here. I live in Washington. We go to the Bible Church in First Baptist Church in Las Vegas, West Las Vegas. It's Spring Mountain, Fort Apache. I'm going to go there at 11 Spring Mountain, Fort Apache. See, when I got born again, God, I cried out to God because I couldn't stop drinking alcohol.
I like that prayer. That was good.
I could not. I knew I needed
on
to surrender.
Your own.
No way. I cried. I said, Lord, it was a point where I was broke. I said, I knew I'd go to hell. I said, I'm sorry to God. I was sorry to God. It's a godly sorrow. I was sorry for using, just like trying to manipulate, trying to live, doing what I want to do. And I knew I needed to give all, but I couldn't do it. So when he granted me repentance, I cried out to God and I said, Lord, deliver me from, I don't want to ever drink again because I'll never be able to serve you if I do this. I could not stop. And I never had a sip. God delivered me immediately from that. There was no way I could stop drinking that time.
That's your testimony, really, for real?
Yeah, for real.
I don't believe you ever drank like that, no.
I was drinking like a functional, like I was really doing work in business. I was drinking like 15 beers. I just drink because I relax my mind. I was thinking about money, other things. I was living in, you know, California. I had a nice home, whatever. But the point, I was drinking because that was my main thing, was the alcohol. But I functioned on it. I was able to, like, you know, you people may not know that, but I drank a lot, man. But my heart was hard, bro.
But look at you working for God now. Look at you, man.
By God's grace, man. This is impossible with me. I'd never do this. I never thought I used to come here and gamble and drink beer when I was 21.
No way, come on.
Oh, yeah. I couldn't believe it, man. It's true.
What a testimony.
God raised me from the dead. But I didn't know I'd be here. I just said, God, I just want to do whatever you want me to do. I started preaching at Walmart, preaching at the stadium, talking to God. God just kept me in this grace upon grace upon grace. But a lot of suffering, even as a believer. My wife divorced me and I got saved. I mean, everything. I mean, God let me suffer radically, but he sustained me to get through that, to get through a lot of anguish. And then he made me depend upon him. That's reality.
Well, I want to be with you.
Just follow Jesus. All we have is Christ, man. There's nothing else, bro. There's nothing else. You know?
This is all vanity.
All vanity, man. All we have is Christ.
Generations, a few decades on the earth. You look good when you were 35, 30. Now you're 70 and you got Alzheimer's, you got problems with the joints, you got arthritis, you can barely walk. I mean, think about 75 years. You did well for yourself for half your life. You became a millionaire, let's say. Let's say you have all the property, you got a bunch of lands, you call them your own names, but men will praise you when you do well for yourself. But he says in Psalm 49 that they will go to the generation of their fathers. They will never see light. Man, though in honor, remaineth not. He is like the beasts that perish. So I don't care how well you think you've done up until this point in your life. If you do not have the righteousness of Christ imputed to you by faith, you've not come into a saving relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, your King, your God, then everything you've done is in vain. It is futile. It is worthless. It is passing away. It is dying. It's fleeting. What is your life? It is even a vapor that appears for a little time and then it vanishes away. That's why a wise man once said, what does it profit a man? The wise man that ever lived, the Lord Jesus Christ, which, what does it profit a man? To gain the whole world and lose his own soul. Yet what will a man give in exchange for his soul? What will you give in exchange for your soul? You'll take all the gold, all the riches, all the wealth, and the health for 70, 80 years, and then die in your sins, and then burn under the wrath of God eternally in unquenchable fire? Is that really worth that to you? Logically, does it make any sense? You could probably even agree with that. But even if you agree, you're still not saved. You must be born again. You can agree, though, yeah, he's probably right, man. We must come to the Savior. You must kiss the Son. Pay homage to the Son, lest he be angry, and you perish in the way when his wrath is kindled but a little. You must come come and state your case, that you may be acquitted. State your case to God, trusting in Christ the mediator, the substitute, the surety, the sponsor, who died in your place to bear your guilt, the only way, the one you're trusting in as the perfect lamb sacrifice, Christ our Passover, so that you will no longer be in that state of guilt, but become innocent in the eyes of God, because God imputes all your sins to him and all his righteousness to you the moment you believe, and then all your life you're going to be sanctified. As a result of that, God's going to confirm his salvation in you, working in you to will and to do for his good pleasure. He says, he who has called you is faithful, who also will do it. He does it all. The question is, if you don't get to that point, you were never saved. You never said, oh, I believe, and then you went off and lost your salvation. Those whom God loves, he chastens. He scourges every son whom he receives. In Hebrews chapter 12, in the Bible, he says, if you're without chastisement, you are a bastard. You're not a child, illegitimate child. God is not your father. That's what the Bible says. That's the language it uses, that you are not a child of God. So if you can continue living in habitual sin, practicing lawlessness, and there's no intervention from God,
There's no stopping you by God in a sovereign power to ordain the circumstance in your life to turn you from what he does not want you doing, as a loving father would turn his child from running into the middle of the street and oncoming traffic to get hit by a car, that God would not do the same for you, knowing what is good and right for you as your Lord, as your daddy, as your savior. If that is not happening in your life, then you are not truly born again. You are not saved. No matter what you say out of your mouth, no matter what you believe in your head, the heart has not been changed. And so we must understand the miracle of the new birth has to take place. Has it happened? Examine yourself as to whether you're in the faith. Test yourself. Do not know yourselves if Jesus Christ is indeed in you, except to be reprobate. To the pure, all things are pure. But to those who are defiled and unbelieving, nothing is pure, but even their mind and their conscience are defiled. They profess that they know God, but by their works they deny him, being abominable, disobedient, unto every good work, reprobate. Jesus himself said in Matthew chapter 7, you'll know them by their fruits. Wolves will come to you in sheep's clothing, saying all the right things, but inwardly they're ravening wolves. They say all the nice things, speak 98% truth, a little couple percent of falsehood. It's like rat poison. 98% food, 2% poison is going to kill you, or kill the rat. 100% truth according to the word of God is a true prophet of God, a spokesman of God, the shepherd of God, the minister of the gospel. And when he errs, he repents. But he says, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but only he who does the will of my Father in heaven on that day. Many will come in my name and say, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied thy name? Cast out devils in thy name and done many wonders in thy name. And I will declare to them, depart from me, I never knew you. You who practice lawlessness, in this the children of God and the children of the devil are manifest. Whosoever does not practice righteousness is not of God. Some of you, that applies to you, profess you know God. You're a believer, a so-called believer in Christ. But your life contradicts your belief. Your faith without works is dead. It's not your works that save you, but saving faith works righteousness and obedience to God by the power of God. You say you believe, but you're out here drinking beer and getting drunk. You're out here gambling. You're out here fornicating. You're out here committing adultery. You're out here entrenched in all kinds of impurity and iniquity. And you're not in your house. Your temple is to be a temple of the Holy Spirit. But if anyone defiles the temple of God, God will destroy him. The temple is your body for God to live in. I will dwell in them and walk in them. I will be their God, and they shall be my people. The temple that you live in, so how could God dwell in that temple? How could God live in a habitation of devils? How can Christ have concord Belial? How can the temple of God have agreement with idols? How can a believer partner with unbelievers? How can righteousness have fellowship with lawlessness? You see, come out from among them and be ye separate, declares the Lord. Touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you. I will be my dear father to you, and you shall be my sons and daughters. This is a stench to those who are perishing. If this is a stench to you, if this is an aroma of death to you, you're perishing. But it is the aroma of life to those who believe. Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. Christ became for his people wisdom from God and righteousness and sanctification and redemption. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. Repent therefore and be converted that your sins may be blotted out so the times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord. Give glory to God in your repentance today.